Now, let's go straight to the subject. I will, this is a big subject. So I will try to do a macro view as much as I can. I'll go quickly a little bit. I would suggest you take some notes if you have some questions, and then maybe we'll have some time for questions and answers. So I will have to cover a large area from, you know, 35,000 feet altitude, so that we can understand the complexity of what's happening and do something about it. I would like to start by saying that this is, I mean, you've heard so much about the world is changing and the world will not be the same, and this is time of great change, and things will, you know, will never be the same again. All of that is correct. I mean, you've heard so much about this, and you've been bombarded by social media and maybe other webinars, and you name it. So what I want to do is to move from listening to all of this into actually seeing what can we do about this. So now it's the time to say, okay, enough talking about this. Now let's see how we can, what do we do about this new reality? How do we act in whatever is going to be changing as the future world? And I want to say that in the end, it will come back to three main questions. Should you stay in your current business? That's number one. Of course, the obvious answer is yes, but this is a fundamental question that applies to every business. Number two, if not, what new business should you go to? Number three, if yes, in what way should you stay in the new business? Can you stay the way you were before, or now because of what's happening, then you should go into transform yourself into a different reality to cope and to match and to adapt what's coming, what's happening now and what's coming, since everybody's talking that how great this is. And I want to have my approach from outside in. I don't want to start locally talking about the, you know, the micro details of how you run an operation. Maybe we can get to that in a short time. But I want to talk about how things are from a macro perspective, then go inside. Because what's changing is that our reality from outside is changing. And we have to understand how the external change has happened so that we understand how we adapt to it. This is not an internal change. This is an external change that has to be matched by an internal process of adaptation. I also want to say that this is not a dead time. I mean, we're all sitting at home. That's fine. But this is not a dead time. In fact, in my thinking, maybe this should be the busiest time ever for you guys, especially people at your level. Because this is the time to think at a strategic level. When you're in the office, you're mainly dealing with crisis management, with day-to-day operations, you know, putting fires off and other routine stuff. But when something of this magnitude happens, then this is the time for deep thinking. So although we're still at home or we're operating from home, but it's not a vacation, this is the time for serious consideration of what do we need to change, what do we need to think about so that we can move forward. So we have to, you know, work at these different deep levels so we understand how things are. First, I'm going to talk a little bit about what is the kind of change that is happening. If anybody tells you that they understand how the future will become in the months and the years to come, then have, you know, big question marks on this, because nobody really knows. There's going to be a million theory about this. Nobody knows why, because if you understand how systems work, you know, the global system and the global business world, how things work, you understand that this is a super complex entity that cannot be understood just by having speculations and theory. So nobody really, really understands, especially when the developments are still emerging. We're still in an emergent situation. The outcome is still developing. So it's still early. What I would recommend in this situation, and that's what I'm doing, is to watch the developments. Just watch them. But don't be overwhelmed by what you see in the media, because the nature of the media, it zooms in on something and it makes it a big deal. Then tomorrow there's another big story. Then after tomorrow there's another big story. And if you're just following that, you know, too closely, you will get lost. So what I suggest is watch the development, of course, what's happening in the world, but don't be stuck there. What I would suggest is do zoom in and zoom out. So zoom in to see what's happening, read the news every day, read reliable news, you know, see what's happening in the world, but immediately zoom out to see how you can connect things together, how you can tie things together so that you can see the big picture and you can watch for signs of trends. Because only if you zoom out and you look at the big picture, it's like a graph. The more you zoom out, the more you can see the trend. So what we have to do is keep doing this operation, watch the details and zoom out to see the big picture, and continuously adjust the frame of vision that we look at things. Keep adjusting it, because it's still dynamic and we don't know how it's going to settle yet. Plan as much as you can to adapt for your day-to-day operation. But remember, it's not clear. So now you have to be adaptive and do not make big strategic decisions. Now is not the time to make very big macro strategic decisions about the nature of your work, because you don't know how the dust will settle yet, and it has not settled. So be careful. Now it's just about observation and analysis, interpretation, and then you can make the big decision after you have more clarity. So what do we do in this context? What we should do is always remind ourselves of our ultimate purpose, and that's to survive and to grow. The big challenge now actually is a survival challenge. So if you're a hero, I mean, if you can survive this as a business and as a person, as a family, if everybody in your family is intact, if your bigger family is intact, if your business is still alive, then you are a hero, because what's happening is a huge tsunami. This is super big. Humanity has never seen something like this. So as a business entity, your main purpose now is, how do I stay alive? Now, in the context of your business, maybe it has its own special situations, right? But still, the overriding challenge is how do I survive? Because survival depends on fitting into your current reality. And when you have your current reality changing so dramatically, so your survival is actually at a threat. And you have to keep on adapting. Growth also depends on the opportunities that are offered to you in your current reality. Like now, there is a big opportunity in this current reality for the hygiene and sanitation industry, and they have to capture it. But as this evolves, there will also be new opportunities when things are settling. So growth also depends on the new reality, on the new normal that will eventually settle down, and all the new potential that will offer. So for the survival and for the growth, you have to keep watching what's happening so that you can adapt to survive and to capture opportunities. Now is a test of your capacity to do that. How can you adapt and how you can evolve? Now it's a test of your character, of the resilience, of your resilience as a person, as an organization, of what you are made of as a business person, as a senior executive, as a CEO, as a top manager, right? As an entrepreneur, as an investment, as an investor, as a service provider. Now is the test. So that's why what you do now is super important. And just because now we're in a crisis situation, gentlemen and ladies, it doesn't mean that this is a justification to lower the quality of what we do. On the contrary, this is not an excuse now to whatever we're doing, our performance, the quality of our performance to go down. On the contrary, this is the time for leadership. This is a time where employees are watching. They're watching you, because in these times, people watch for signals of how to behave, especially when they observe authority, when they observe what we call, you know, the leadership. So when they observe you, and they will either be inspired by what you're doing, and the way you will conduct yourself will help them in their survival and growth, or you will teach them a bad lesson that will eventually reflect on them and will reflect on you. This is a time when your bosses are watching. How are you adapting, right? Are you taking this as a vacation, or are you being as adaptive as possible, you know, trying to fit this current change that happened, but remain your productivity, remain your contribution, even if it has to be in different ways, because of course now things have changed, but still there is a million ways that you can be productive. So your bosses are watching, your colleagues are watching, because we also take signals from each other on how to behave. So this is a time that you are conscious of yourself, so that you make sure that you're inspiring people around you and yourself all the time. The market is also watching your resilience, your behavior, your capacity to adapt, the quality of your work, your true values that are manifested in your actions now, that are under tremendous pressure at these times. And as it says, these kinds of times, you know, when you put a structure under so much pressure, it is the best test of where the weaknesses are and where the structure will break and where the structure is really strong. So this will bring the best of us, at the same time it will bring the worst of us. That's why you have to really be conscious. A very important part to focus on is the issue of our branding. Branding is very important. You know, it takes ages and years to build a brand, which is about how the market perceives you, your reputation in the market. So be very careful, because you could lose your brand in a second in this situation, because the market is watching, especially your clients. So be very careful in how you treat your clients. Be very careful how you treat your employees. The most important things for you now is to stay calm, not passive. I'm not talking about being passive. On the contrary, you have to be extremely alert and vigilant to observe what's happening. So stay calm, observe, reflect, keep analyzing things, make as many interpretations as you can, because God knows what will, you know, which one will be right. Prepare as much as you can, experiment as much as you can, because this is time for experimentation, right? And take your time to make big decisions. Not now. Do not make big decisions now. Remember, it's easy to make a choice, but it's very hard, right? The hard part is that you'll have to live with your choice for a long, 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 long time to go. So be careful. I'm going to talk a little bit about the macro picture now from a globalization point of view. You know what? Globalization is important because globalization is about how you conduct your business in a global environment. It's about how the freedom and the rules that we have, or the regulations that define how do we act in a global market. You know, how you do businesses with other entities, how you move, how you manage your supply chain, how you, where you sell, where you import from. So all of this is part of globalization. And what I want to tell you is that globalization now is under big test. Why am I saying this? Why is this important? Because you need to pay attention how the rules will change after this is over. And I expect the rules will change. Will globalization die? I don't think so, because too much has been invested, and it's so important, you know, for the world that it cannot be reversed at this stage. But it will slow down definitely, and the rules will change. So you have to monitor how the rules are changing in a global environment in terms of export, import, trade, tariffs, you know, all of that, so that you know how to adjust your business accordingly. I expect globalization to slow down a little bit until we find, you know, a stable place we can fit, put our feet, and then decide, okay, how do we start reconstructing the global economy all over again. So keep watching on what's happening globally from a globalization perspective, because in the end, that's the context of the way, you know, most of us do businesses now. I'm going to talk about a little bit about macroeconomics here, because that also gives an overview. And I know that you are my audience, you know, are senior people, and you look at things from a macro point of view. Is depression coming? Yes. Recession coming? Yes, there is going to be recession. Some people talk about multiple recessions. We don't know this, but definitely the global GDP, you know, has gone down. Productivity everywhere at the local and the global level has gone down. But eventually there will be recovery. Of course, like every time in history, there will have to be recovery. Is it going to be fast and sharp recovery, or is it going to be slow recovery? We don't know. It depends how long this takes, the extent of the damage that it will create. You know, if this takes for 3 months is something, if this takes 18 months is something else, because every day is costing the world billions and billions and billions of dollars. So the recession is becoming, every day we close, the recession is going to become deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper. I expect that after this is over, the US will try very hard to do a V-shaped recovery. And I don't know if you know what a V-shaped recovery is. Is, you know, we're going down very quickly. I'm sure you know that. But V-shaped recovery means we go up also very quickly. Now, they will try to do that because this is an election year in the United States. So Trump, you know, after 4 years of boosting the economy to the level it was a few months ago, now suddenly everything has collapsed. It is in his interest, and for the sake of his legacy, and because also he's a businessman to start with, he will try to boost it back again. So they already commissioned something like, I don't know, $2.3 trillion to jumpstart and as a economic stimulus to boost the economy again when started. And I expect that more of this will come. There will be more billions of dollars injected. So Trump will try to do that. But because this is at a global level, you know, China, India, Europe, the whole world now has frozen to a great extent, I expect that it will be a U-shaped recovery. I don't expect that it will be a V-shaped recovery. That's my interpretation. It's going to be a U-shape. So we're going down, we'll stay down for some time, and then we'll gradually start going up. Now, how deep we go down, nobody really knows. because this is unprecedented. Nothing like this has happened before. I'll just give you an example. In the aviation industry, you know, aviation industry has completely, almost completely frozen now. And the tourism industry that has been hit, and these are two global businesses that have been hit because of what happened to, you know, the globalized nature of our economies. Now, it is some theory says that it will take time for the tourism industry and the aviation industry to pick up again, because people are cautious, you know, and it will take time for them to trust going out, you know, and go back to their normal life. That's one theory. But another theory is saying, you know what, people have been stuck in their homes for a long time, so as soon as this is over, it's going to be an absolute rush and push into traveling again. And there has been some countries, and this is, that's why I said keep observing what's happening, that people have been actually applying for vacations right after the coronavirus is over. Why? Because people are making plans that when this is over, you know, we're stuck at home and we're social creatures. We're not used to being at home for such a long time and not interacting. We're social creatures in the end. So millions of people have decided, apparently, that after this is over, they're just going to take vacations and travel and travel and travel as much as they can to make up for all the time they've been together. So we have to watch all of this. And because of this, because of the nature of this dynamic thing, we don't know if it's going to be, you know, a long U-shape or a short U-shape. But definitely we're going to go to recovery, because I feel the fundamentals, many of the fundamentals are still there. I think what was driving the UK, the US economy in the past, and that's the main economy, are still there, some of the main forces. And I think people there will do everything they can to go back to what it was. So I'm optimistic. I don't think it will take as long as what the pessimists have been saying. Okay? And I think the US will do what it's best to push us, to pull us back forward. And this has to be soon, because the elections are in November. Now, I'm going to talk about a little bit about the changes in the business world. You've heard so much about, you know, some businesses will disappear. It is possible, but we don't know. I don't think many businesses will disappear. I think most businesses will have to transform. So we're going to go into a period of transformation. There will be new businesses because there are new opportunities now. You know, it's obvious. Now the world will become digital, online business will go up, you know, and online to offline will go up. Things like surveillance, hygiene, sanitation, all of that will go up. There might be other also opportunities. And because this has happened, there will be a wave of innovations. 5G will go faster, I think. And there's going to be a new generation of internet, because it has proven how important it is now. It's actually a miracle that internet has not collapsed with so much use now. We're so lucky, because it has been disaster if this has, you know, collapsed even. So all of this will come. So what we need to do, as I said, keep observing for opportunities that will emerge, because the nature of business is changing, and definitely most of us will be transforming. So for your business, I don't think your business will disappear. I mean, it will not disappear, obviously, the nature of your business, but it will definitely have to transform itself and integrate new elements in the way the process is done, in the way supply chain is done in your case. There will be definitely more elements of hygiene, sanitation, and the way you handle all your, you know, goods and services. All of that also will be integrated. So definitely things will change. Now, let's talk more about more practical issues of how all of us, you and me and everybody, should think about this. What should be our orienting philosophy so that we can know how to handle this? Remember always, our ultimate purpose is to survive and grow. That's what we need to do. How do we stay alive in this very threatening situation as businesses, as people, as professionals, as job, you know, as even individuals, as families, whatever it is, right? And how do we find opportunities in this new changing environment so that we grow? Because the current reality is so huge that obviously nothing will be the same. So as I said, we don't only have to observe, but we have to focus. Focus is very important. You need to focus. You need to have this ability to remove all these distractions from around you, especially what's happening on the social media. I mean, the first few weeks of everybody was panicking, and, you know, people were just throwing up on social media, and because we needed to communicate, right? everybody was in a panic and a trauma situation. Now things, I think, we're beyond denial. Now we are gradually going into the acceptance stage. So we have to calm down, and we have to learn how to focus again. We have to organize our thinking as executive, as senior executive. We cannot be stressed. You cannot be stressed, because if you're stressed, you cannot think. If you can't think, you cannot focus. We will have to learn how to manage ourselves, how to manage ourselves personally, so that we can maintain our sanity, our mental sanity, our emotional sanity, intellectual sanity, so that we can make good interpretations and good decisions. We need to prepare scenarios. You guys need to prepare scenarios. Maybe you've been doing that, or you're starting to think about this. What if this continues for 3 months? What if this continues for 6 months? What is the scenario? What do we do if this continues 12 months? What do we do if there is a second wave coming in November? What do we do if Corona actually stays part of our nature, and it will come back next year again? Because, okay, we're doing a vaccine now, but what if this stays like a flu, like N1H1, and then the coming vaccine will not be good for next year's Corona? Who knows? Nobody knows. Or it might be a case now, you know, somebody might discover a cure, and in 3 months' time, every country has this cure, and we go back to life, and like, you know, everything back to normal. Who knows? But you have to have these scenarios. This is the time for imagination. You have to use your imagination. It's very important. How can we do our business in a different way, considering now, you know, this new reality? This is a time for experimentation. Experiment as much as you can, of course, within the constraints of the nature of your work. Then after you do that, see what works, and then we have to integrate this. So, preparation, imagination, experimentation, and then integration, so that when we go back to business, we start, you know, we start actually the process of transformation that has been done based on focus and planning and deep thinking, and then we can construct our reality. You can't say, I mean, it will be a disaster if you wait until all of this is over, and then let's say in 3 months' time we go back to work, and then we go back to work and have our first meeting and say, okay, guys, what should we do now? If you do that, it's too late, it's done, finished. People have already been ahead of you. So we need to do all of that. Now, we also need to watch for what are these new emerging needs. The nature of business has not really changed, in the sense that it's all about satisfying needs or creating new needs that haven't been recognized yet. Right? That's the nature of the business. This has been before the Corona, and it's still now, and it will continue afterwards. So what we have to do is apply the same kind of concept. Okay, go back to your loyal clients, go to your clients and do focus group, do whatever. Ask your loyal clients, how do they want you to serve them again? How do they want to be served in this new reality? They might tell you, no, the product and services that you have been giving me now is not acceptable. To feel more reassured, I need you to do it in this way and that way and that way. You know, I will not touch this product, I will not touch the service you're giving me unless it is sanitized and whatever. So you have to go back to them and ask them, in this new reality, right, how do they expect you to provide the services and the product back to them? You have to watch their behavior, the customer behavior. In what way it's changing, so that you can adapt your operation accordingly. And maybe you need to apply some design thinking. And design thinking, yani, start with the end. Ask yourself, what is the end? How is it? What's the shape of my end product and end service? How is it going to look like now in this new reality? And then you have to engineer reverse engineering, engineer backward. Okay, how can I change the processes so that I end up giving my clients what they expect me to give them in this new reality? Okay, so keep very good focus on your purpose. Always remind yourself, what's your purpose as an entity, right? What's your purpose? Why do you exist? Because that's the fix. That's not a variable. That's the fundamental. So why do we exist? Because these are fundamental times. So we have to ask ourselves these extreme deep questions. Why do we exist? Okay, then go back, you know, my model of leadership, the 3 P's: purpose, then process, then participation. So what's our purpose, and has it changed? No. Okay, how do we now design a process that is based on the new current emerging reality, the emerging reality that's happening now? How do we redesign our process accordingly, our strategy? I will talk about that now later, right? And then how do we behave? How do we do a participation, the contribution? How do we act in a way that meets all this? that makes us adaptive to this new reality. You have to go back to thinking as the founders. Put yourself in the founders' mentality. It's a new world now. Okay, let's start from scratch. Let's go back and start from scratch, right? What do we, how do we make sure that the purpose of our existence, why we have been created, continues to fulfill itself in this, what's happening now in these times of changes and when things settle down? These are very important questions that you should ask yourself. You can also, go back and do your SWOT analysis, you know, this classical old style thing. What about your strengths? Do the strengths still apply now? What about your weaknesses? Do your weaknesses still apply? What about the previous threats opportunities and threats? Do they still apply now, or do we have now new kind of opportunities, new kind of threats? So do that. I have a different approach. I use more adaptive approach that's based on evolution and biology and the way all this is integrated into business. I ask usually myself these fundamental questions. Okay, in this new reality, what do I need to keep from what I have now, from the way I function as a business, as a, you know, as an entity? What is the fundamentals that have proven that are unshakable, right? So what do I need to keep? What part of my business DNA we need to keep? Because this proves that in any situation, even as big as this one, it cannot change. Second, what should I completely eliminate because it's obviously it's useless anymore. Now we can't do it the same way. So what do we eliminate, right? And in every business, there's so much that needs to be eliminated, so much dead wood that is piling there that we do it just out of routine and old processes and legacy. But now it's time to kick that out, right? You don't need it anymore. Three, what should we do less of, right? Because we don't need to do so much of that because times have changed. Three, four, what do we need to do more of? Because obviously this has been more emphasized. You know, I'll give an example. If you had one sanitizer in the past in the whole office, now you need maybe 20 sanitizers. Maybe in your offices you need 50, who knows? I'm just giving you a small example. So what do we need to do more of and what do we need to do less of? The most important one is what are the new skills and capabilities and assets that we need to acquire and learn? What is it that's completely new that we don't know how to do, that we didn't do before, that we have to start doing from now on? Okay? What is it that we have to do from all over again, that we have to do from, we have to learn so that we can integrate it and make it part of our new reality? But remember, while we're doing all of that thinking, don't make the decisions now. Now is not the time for big decisions. Now is the time to just stay alive, adapt for your day-to-day thing, but plan so that when the time comes, you actually put all these decisions into action. Because we're still at the beginning of this, or at least midway, and our standing is incomplete, right? So now is the main challenge is survival. I also want you to think about structure. Look inside and ask yourself about your structure. Does our current, our old structure still apply? Does it still apply as old structure? Or do we need to readjust our structure based on the new reality? What about our financial stability and robustness? What about our cash flow, right? It would be absolutely stupid if we let an experiment, an event like this pass without making us smarter and wiser. This is so expensive to all of us. The world has lost trillions and trillions of dollars. Every business has lost. We have lost emotional pressure, emotional loss, even physical loss. Some people lost their loved ones. Business loss, opportunities lost. I mean, you name it. If we come out of this without having learned, it will be the most foolish thing ever. So ask yourself, in terms of cash flow, what can we learn now so that we maintain our cash flow so that if they were next, you know, similar kind of changes, you know, Corona phase 2, Corona phase 3, God knows what will happen in the future, or other kinds of disasters, natural disasters. I mean, who knows? Maybe the same, not the same scale, but a different scale. How can we maintain a healthy cash flow? How can we maintain a very solid and robust, you know, financial stability? This is a time for CFOs to think at this level, and this is the time of CEOs to ask the CFOs to come up with these kinds of plans. The same thing applies to You know, human resources. Okay, that's what should be the role of human resources now? Because the nature of work, as you know, is changing. People are working from home. You will be more having freelancers, more outsourcing of businesses. So how do we manage all of this? How do we manage these contracts? How do we lead people in this environment? Is your leadership style the same, or do we have to reinvent and rethink leadership all over again? I think we have to rethink leadership, because we have to adapt our leadership style to a new world, to a new level of challenges. So HR also has a major role. KPIs, how do you measure KPIs now? Can you keep the same KPIs, or do you introduce new elements into KPIs now? How do you manage people remotely? These are technical issues I will not go into, because I would like to stay on a macro level, but HR has a big role now to reinvent yourself. Operating procedures, the rules and regulations, and all the things, the way we do things, the processes start internally, you know? Do they still apply, or much of them has to be reduced, and we have to get the new ones into order? How do we communicate? How do we communicate internally and externally during this crisis and after this crisis? To our people and to the world and to our, you know, direct customers and our indirect customers. What all challenges that we had before and they're not relevant anymore? There must be all challenges before that are not relevant anymore. How can we let go of them, not worry about them? What new challenges have emerged, right, that we didn't think of before, but now there are new challenges that we have to deal with? So as you can see, all my talk is about a strategic perspective, because you're sitting at home now, or in your whatever, in the way you're operating, and there's little manual work, relatively speaking, but there's so much intellectual work that has to come, planning, understanding, observing, so that when we say, okay, go back to business, you already have your plans. You know, 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, and you're up and running. We have with a completely transformed mentality. Now, culture, you have to ask yourself, is your purpose clear for you and all your staff? Is your culture adaptive enough? Is it resilient enough? What's the resilience of your structure and your company? What about the discipline in your culture? Is there enough discipline in your culture to act in times of crisis and these kind of shocks? Because this shock obviously has shown us our vulnerabilities. So what has this shock exposed? It definitely has exposed everything about us. Because you put a system under pressure, the truth, the core of this reality comes out. What about the vulnerabilities? And you have to be absolutely, you know, absolutely honest about this. Ask yourself now when it comes to strategy. If you have a strategy, then is the strategy still applicable, or we have to refine the strategy all over, from scratch? Ask yourself if there are opportunities for mergers and acquisitions. Do we have opportunities for mergers with other entities or to acquire other entities if you have the cash? Ask yourself if you are ready for the upcoming recession. What if, you know, recession hits us really bad, and how can we survive in that case? You have to have contingency plans for all of this. Ask yourself, are you prepared in a position so that you capture the best of the recovery phase? Because when recovery comes, you know, whoever gets it first, the opportunities, will prove themselves to be a first comer. So ask yourself, are you ready for that? And ask yourself, should you focus on your key or core business now, or should you now go into new areas? Who knows, maybe you should discover new areas. I mean, people who used to do perfumes, now they're thinking about doing sanitizers, doing, you know, medical alcohols, because they have the machines for that. People who do wine and these kind of alcoholic industries, they have the entire infrastructure now to do things related to pharmaceutical to the industry. So now they're shifting there, because they see that in the next few months there will be business there. So ask yourself the same question. Are you ready and positioned and saying for recovery? Now, I want to tell you that it is very hard to lead in these situations. It's very, very hard to lead in situations, because this is a time for high tension. It's a time for high stress. People are panicking. Situation is volatile. There's an emotional roller coaster. I mean, take it from you. One day you wake up happy, it's fine, your spirit is up. The next day, or even the same afternoon, you get depressed. You get fed up from sitting being in four walls and confine yourself just to a small screen. So people will go through emotional roller coaster. So allow for that. Remember that you have to lead internally at home with your team and with the larger, you know, your, maybe your clients and the larger environment within this scope of emotional volatility. And each person expresses their emotions differently. Look at your family and your team. Some people go introvert, some people go explode, some people become angry, some people go divergent, some people go hyper, some people become moody, some people become aggressive, some people become really depressed. The introverts become more introvert, extroverts become, they go mad because they can't go out. So you have to allow for all of that, and you have to lead people while keeping this in mind. People, now it's a time of disorientation, it's lack of control. This is time of huge pressure, of fear and uncertainty. So you have to make sure that you are leading people who are going through all of this. But remember, in these times, people go to authority. Family, your kids and your you know, children go to their parents in disguise to look for certainty. Your staff, they look at you to for centered certainty. You will go to your bosses to look for certainty. So in whatever position you are, if your position of authority at home or your business, small scale or large scale, whether you like it or not, people are looking at you. Now is the time to be the strongest person in your family, the strongest person in your team, so that you can give them support. Is that easy? It's very hard. You know why? Because you still have to manage yourself, and you yourself are going under and through all of these pressures. So you have to manage your sanity emotionally and intellectually and maintain focus and think clearly. At the same time, manage other people who are also volatile and exploding or going in different directions. And that's a very hard thing to do. So you have to know how to do that, right? Reminding them of clarity of purpose is very important. For your family, you tell them now what matters is to stay alive. For your staff, you tell them now what matters is to maintain, you know, the minimum level of our business and do whatever it is so that we can come out of this with minimum damage. So you have to remind them of these mega things. You have to make sure that your priorities are rearranged accordingly now, because they are differing time. Now is the time to say the truth. Always say the truth. Never ever lie. Always say the truth. No matter how hard is the truth, say the truth to people around you. Of course, at different levels, but package it in different ways, because people handle truth in different ways. So you know how to have to know how to handle it, how to present it. But never, never disorient people by deviating from the truth, because then there's going to be a trust issue and people will not trust you anymore. So be very clear and direct, but say it in a tactful way. Over communicate and do it intelligently as much as you can. And remember that people need over communication. A million times we will have to reassure people now. And people will have to speak now, because people, because they're stressed, they need to vent out all their stress by talking. So you have to be a great listener, because communication, half of communication is listening. And part of relieving our stress is to talk and talk and talk. It's the talk therapy. So you have to listen. And you have to manage your own stress and emotions. You have to also sacrifice. This is time for sacrifice. So before you ask your people to sacrifice, you have to be the first to do that, to lead for example, by example, and to develop trust. So now is the time to lead by example, so that people will trust you and they will remember that. Whatever you do now, it will be remembered, because these times, you know, will change us forever and it will shape us forever. And these times stick. It is very strong and harsh and aggressive intervention in our life, right? It's like in difficult times, as you said, your friends, you know your friends in the difficult time, whether they stand next to you or they run away. And this is the same thing. So you have to lead by example. Involve as many people as you can to help you and help others. It's not the time of ego. So if you need help, get help. If you need to involve people, involve people. Change the old rules, you know? The rules are not the Quran or the Bible. Change them. Simplify things as much as you can. This is not the time for, you know, being, you know, going by the book. What matters now is you stay alive and you're ready for what's coming next, you know, in terms of opportunities or maybe even different kind of stress. So simplify the rules, right? Simplify them and create new rules, substitute for them if you have to, while maintaining the basic, you know, your basic values that are necessary, your like integrity and honesty and all of that, right? Be creative as much as you can. Be creative and try things until something works well, and manage yourself. Manage yourself, manage your emotions, and the last and not least is have hope. There is a difference between hope and optimism. Optimism is just a feeling. Hope is about, I'm going to do everything I can, and I have faith that in the end it's going to be fine. So this is the time of hope, right? Hope means we're going to do everything we can, and if we do that well, we have absolute faith that things will turn fine. So inject hope in yourself, because that's the job of leadership. Inject hope in your team, because that's what leadership is about. It's about becoming an agent of hope, right? And sooner or later, with an adaptive mindset, with the right way of exercising leadership, right? Knowing how to adapt and evolve, we will not only come out of this alive, hopefully, as a business, as a team, as professionals, as families, you know, as a country, as humanity, we should come out of this smarter. And who knows, after these kind of, you know, terrible shocks, usually this time for unexpected opportunities. And I expect that there will be a wave of new opportunities and innovations happening. So we have to be ready for the promises of the future, and hopefully we'll be smart by then and well prepared to capture them and be ready to, you know, for a better phase of life. I better stop now so that I can give you some chance to reflect, and if you want to ask questions, I'm more than happy.
Thank you very much, Michael. I think that was a lot of really, really good information, and hopefully also a lot of motivation for everyone to contribute to this opportunity finding exercise that we're also going through at the moment.
Yes. Does anybody have any question? I'm ready.
Thank you very much, Michael. This is Naif, Transom Handling.
Ahlan, Naif.
Very insightful, and I've been taking quite a lot of notes. I could barely catch up with the various ideas. I think at this stage, it's, you know, it's about people as well.
Correct.
How do you ensure, I mean, as a leader, that everyone is on board with you? Because as you rightly mentioned, everyone would have his own speculation, everyone is vulnerable. How do you ensure that we're all into this together? Because sometimes we also have to make very tough decisions as well on people, unfortunately.
Yes.
So how do you ensure that we're, you know, collectively we're all aligned eventually, and the people are supportive of you eventually as a leader?
Okay. The main word that comes to mind, my friend, is the word trust. You can't lead people who don't trust you. So you have to manifest trust to them in the most possible way. And as you rightly said, it is all about people. I mean, the most important word, I mean, my definition is leadership is about mobilizing people, whether they are groups or organizations, to move forward, to create a better future for themselves, so they can survive and grow. So it's about people. It's all about people. And this is not talk, because people talk about this all the time. Companies talk about this all the time. I mean, look at some of the companies in this stage. People go to their website, and the first thing they did, you know, when they were shut down, they fired 10 or 20% of their people. Now, how can you keep talking about people come first, and then while the problem has just hit them hard, you know, you tell them you're fired. So they're not only worried about their future health, they're now worried about their sustainability. And I've heard so many stories where under so much pressure, people are now, there's more rates of suicide, there are more divorces happening, you know, there are more depressions, there's more violence, because people are under huge pressure. So the last thing people want from you is to put them under unnecessary extra pressure and to show that you don't care about them. This is the time that people will remember forever, you know. 50 years from now, we'll talk about these days, and we will remember who stood by us and who abandoned us. So if leadership is about people, you never abandon your people. So you make sure that the message is clear to everybody, all your people, that I'm about you. Your safety and security comes first now. And this has to be felt, not just by talk. They have to know that you don't care about business now. I mean, you care, but not to the extent that you would put their life at risk or their families at risk, right? So they really have to feel the genuine concern from you about their well-being. You have to do that. When you do that, when people trust that you have their life, their safety, their sanity, right, their best interest in your mind, and this is a priority for you, they will trust you. Then it becomes easier for you to orient them in different directions, because once they trust you and you extend your hand and they hold it, then you can move forward with them, right? But you have to reassure them for trust. Now, if you have to make big decisions now, as I said to you, I highly recommend you don't make very strategic decisions now, because the earth is still volatile. I mean, you don't build when the earthquake is still shaking. You have to wait until the earthquake has stopped and there are no, you know, second waves and third waves, you know, but after the earthquake there are multiple waves, right? Until all of that settles and you have to do all your geological tests, then you start reconstructing. So don't make big decisions now. So I'll talk from a humanitarian point of view. Even if it's painful, if you can, do not fire people now. Don't fire people. I mean, if you really can, I know it's hard, but imagine somebody already scared to death about their life and the life of their, you know, families and kids and parents and God knows what's in their life, right? Now you tell them your job has been lost. I mean, for God's sake, this is too much. Now is too much. I mean, there's a limit how much stress we can handle. So you are really pushing people to the limit if we do that. And we shouldn't do it if we can. If we can. If we can absolutely have no way and we have to take some difficult decision, then what do we do? I mean, that's the nature of reality. There are doctors who are taking decisions who to keep alive and who to save. I mean, this is, we're talking about this kind of situation now. But if you can, reassure people as much as you can. And once they have seen that, and once you have shown that you can sacrifice, and you are sacrificing as much as you're asking them to sacrifice, then they will trust you, then their ability and capacity to swallow more of these painful decisions are best. So what you have to do with them is what I'm doing now with you. Keep giving them hope. Hope, hope, hope. And always assure them that safety and security comes first. Their families comes first. Before asking them about their work, tell them, how's your family? Is everybody fine? Parents fine? You're fine? Taking precautions, you know? Make them feel that you care about them as humans, not as their machines, so that you can buy their loyalty forever. And then tell them what I'm telling you now on the smaller level. On a micro level, tell them what I'm telling you now. In terms of, it's time to think, to prepare. Each one in the whole department, as a small team. Go to your smaller team, you know, smaller supervisors, wherever they are in the hierarchy level, and give them the same kind of input and insights that I have been giving them, and task them with the process of preparing themselves and adapting at their own scale for a new phase. So involve them, because adaptation happens at every cell. You know, for your body to adapt, you can't just your heart adapt without your lung adapting. Everything has to adapt. So make sure that everybody is involved in adapting to the new reality at their own, you know, but their own parts and bits of the business. So that when, number one, you train them, number two, they are ready for this mentality, number three, when you go back and you say, everybody, okay, yalla, let's go back to work, and, you know, it's going to be a different thing, let's transform, at least they're ready. So the best way is to involve them, you know, involve them in this. This is, don't take it, I'm going to do the whole thing, and then I'm going to send it to you like a pizza delivery, and you just eat it. It doesn't work like this. Everybody has to adapt now. And they're already doing it at their home. Teach them how to do it in their work, and guide them through it step by step.
Thank you very much, Michael.
Any other question?
Sorry, Michael, if I can, thank you very much really for this buffet of wisdom and advice and questions. I think there's a lot of questions in what you've shared with us. I turn to another topic. How are you and how is Lebanon?
Thank you.
And families in Lebanon.
See, this is applying what we have been talking about. Thank you so much for caring about me personally and my family. We're fine. My father is, you know, above 80, so we're taking care of him, trying to keep him as safe as possible. We also have somebody in the family who is, you know, they have an immunity problem, so we're also protecting them. So are we worried? Yes, we're very worried, but like everybody else, we're taking all the precautions. And as I said, I say to myself, we will be heroes if we come out of this as a family, you know, as loved ones, safe and sound. That's what matters most. The rest, we will take care of it. But having said that, I'm also trying to be as productive as possible and adapting my work and what I'm doing as much as I can. This has given me a chance to think about two more books. I've written 10 books now about leadership and strategy so far. I've already started another book, and I have a list of other books that I want to work. So I'm using also this time in applying what I have been sharing with you to think strategically and see how we can turn what we have learned now into leadership insights for the world for after the corona thing is over. But thank you for asking. I hope your family as well is also well.
Yeah, Alhamdulillah. We are really working very hard to try and bring about hope and stay calm. I have one question, and give also to our colleagues. When you say, now is not the time to make drastic decisions or big decisions.
Yes.
And everybody is familiar, and I think our team here are also very much connected to this reality. When you have authority, let us talk about authority, which is higher, than oneself. Which demands, action, and which is looking at scenarios, and everybody is, nobody really is accurate in scenario making now. It's speculation and feelings, and maybe their optimism, or in some situation, maybe they're also their agenda, how they want people to handle this situation. How do you handle, the situation when you are required to take, certain drastic decisions? And do them now, especially when it comes around money and the survivability of a business.
Yes. It's a difficult situation, because it's a situation where things are not in your hand. You're not controlling it. So, and it's coming from a higher authority. There's so much of this pressure there. The first thing I would do is I try to put myself in their shoes to see how is the perspective from their side, so that at least when I build my judgment, I am fair in my judgment and I don't make wrong assumptions, because I understand what's happening now. With the price of oil going so low, many countries that depend on oil are having to challenge to deal with a huge challenge in the months to come, because of their cash flow situation and their economic robustness also. So I understand the pressure that people have on. But again, I think it would be wrong at their level not to consider what we have been talking about and to take in these special times drastic strategic measures. I'll just give you an example. A friend of mine 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago said, I don't need my regional operations, my regional offices. And this friend has a number of regional offices. I discovered that we can work from home. I'm going to move all my work to working from home. And that will save me so much rent, so much. And I said, take it easy. You are just starting this, Will you feel the same way about working from home a month from now? Or you're just caught up in the excitement of this new thing? Because we're human beings in the end, we need to interact. So don't take decisions as at the level, close my operations in that country, minimize number of staff. We discovered that technology works. Let's move to, an online, Zoom-based or Microsoft Teams-based operation. Wait, you can't make these decisions. What if this took 3 months or 4 months? What if people got depressed at home? You cannot make that kind of decision. You can adapt short term, but wait until this settles, because the information is not clear. So people are making decisions before the image is complete. So my best advice for you as a CEO for this company is there's no alternative to negotiating with authority. There's no alternative, because you can't fire authority. What can you do? Can you fire authority? You can't fire your boss. In some cases, it's an unfortunate fact. Right? In many cases, it's unfortunate you can't fire your boss.
Dance with the elephant.
Exactly, you have to dance with the elephant. In my terminology, it's like another piece. It's like dancing with the elephant. So you have to dance with the elephant. And if the elephant now is panicking and under pressure and has not heard this talk that we're having, then oh my God, that you have a disaster, because you're dancing with a panicking elephant. But there's no substitute, because you can't go back to authority and say, you're wrong. Right? I will not do that. You cannot do that. Then you have a bigger problem. So negotiate, and try to inject some of these insights into what we're talking to them, try to delay, play some maneuvers, create some whatever, artificial delay. I mean, everybody has cards up in their sleeve. Play the process time, do whatever it is, because they are also people. And you will be shocked, my friend, you will be shocked how many of those who you look up to as authority and, you know, the rocks of your operation, how under pressure they completely turn into panic and into impulsive thinking and short-term thinking. Because they're human beings, you can't judge them. And this is all revealing itself now. So negotiate, dance with the elephant, play on time, offer alternatives as much as you can, offer different scenarios, ask yourself, what is the purpose of what they're suggesting? Because sometimes they get stuck in one proposal. So asking yourself, what is really that you want to do? What's the problem that you're trying to solve? If you ask this question, maybe you can go back to them and tell them, listen, if this is your main objective, and I see it, and it makes sense, maybe we can do it in this way. So you offer them a solution that will fulfill their core objective without having to go through the suggestion or the request, the director's request that they make. So offer as many alternatives as you can. And is it going to be an easy process? It is not going to be an easy process, especially if the nature of the authority that you have is authoritarian or is stubborn or is non-negotiable, you know, a non-negotiable culture. It's very hard to do that. But this is the time to be as, you know, you have to be realistic because you can't change the world. And sometimes, I mean, in some countries, you know, there's curfew and people going out. I mean, what do you do? This nature of people is like that. Sometimes people are putting them in jail and they're still breaking the laws. And sometimes where, I mean, look at Florida. Florida, compare Florida with New York. New York, lockdown, Florida, everybody's on the beach. Completely different mentality. I mean, people are telling the governor there, are you mad? Listen, look what's happening to New York. How are you letting your people go on the beaches? It's, no, don't worry about it. It's all exaggerated. And then you get a crisis happening. So what I'm saying, you have to be fair with yourself on how much you can change, you know, authority because it's not in your hand. So you have to play all the tricks that you have to ameliorate and mitigate the damage that they can do by, you know, relationship, by delaying things, by time, by processes, by offering arguments. But in the end, if you have no choice, I mean, what do you do if you have no choice? No choice is no choice. In the end, there's a limitation. If your boss tells you, give me 10% of your staff, and what can you tell him? No? He will say, okay, leave. Somebody else will do it. There's a limit, right? So you have to be also fair with yourself on how much you can do. But don't leave any technique that you can use to influence that decision. Maybe through other people. Talk to friends. Talk to whatever. Play on time. Come to approach them in a different way. But it's a very hard situation. It's a very hard situation. And I understand what you're saying. But that's the price that we have to pay at these times. I mean, what do you do? Sometimes, you know, people make bad decisions. And as we see now, I mean, in countries, people have made bad decisions. They've delayed it. They've delayed taking the right precautions. And as a result, thousands of people have died because they didn't take it seriously. So that's the price of the reality of the world. People make mistakes and other people pay the price. But do your best, my friend. Negotiate, dance with the elephant, offer alternatives, but then accept reality.
Michael, my name is Siad. I have one question. This is on the purpose-driven growth model, the PDG, which you have also written in one of your books, Beyond Strategy.
Yes, it's here.
Now the organizational purpose and profitability.
Yes.
You know, being the key guiding factors for growth. In the current scenario where the profitability itself is at stake, how do we define the PDG model at this point of time? I'm moving further, maybe 6 to 7 months down the line. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Well, going back to the model starts by what's your uniqueness, number one. What's the new unique role that you're playing? The second is what's your purpose that's based on your uniqueness? And then the third one is, you know, look at your strategy. What should be your strategy so that you can fulfill the purpose of your organization? And then you go into looking inside and seeing if you're ready to fulfill that strategy or not, and what should you do to improve your readiness to apply a successful and smart strategy. And then you apply this, whatever you've seen, you're looking inside, you know, the diagnostic part, and you fix it, and then you go to the almost the last phase, which is implementation, execution, and then you create an adaptive culture, learning culture, so that this is always, you know, updating itself. So you apply the same one. Now you ask yourself, has the uniqueness of my organization changed? Is it changing now? After this is over, will my role, the uniqueness of my role, will it change? If it changed, then you have to re-adapt your purpose accordingly. In many cases, it hasn't changed because it's based on needs and the needs of the market and on what makes you special. So I don't think your uniqueness has changed. That's why your purpose has not changed. What has changed now is strategy, right? So you have to now to reconsider your strategy. And what is strategy? Strategy is having the best guess that you can have on how to move forward, knowing what you know now. It's a guess. I'll say it again. Strategy is the best guess for moving forward, knowing what you know now. Now, what you know now is dynamic, and it will stay dynamic until things slowly start to settle down. In fact, it will stay dynamic for a long time because it will take time until we see new needs emerging, and then some of the needs will be temporary, the new ones, and then it will stabilize because some things will stay the same. Some things will change for a certain period of time, and some things will change forever. And this needs time to be clear. So you need to observe all that and accordingly readjust your strategy. And then you go back inside to yourself and ask yourself, do I have what it takes to apply my new strategy? And then after you've asked this question, you make sure that you have these components, and then you go to the implementation phase and the execution phase and make it happen. Now, at this stage, I don't think profitability now is the prime objective. I mean, if you can think about this now, depending, of course, on the nature of your business, then you're lucky. Now, in some cases, like people, companies or industries that make detergents, now is the time for them to make money. Sanitation business, now is the time to make money. The delivery business, now is the time to make money. The online business, it's now to make money. But other businesses, you know, how can you make if you're an airport now, if you're in a hotel, you know, if you're in tourism business, how can you even think about profitability? So we have to be realistic. Now, the most profitable thing to do is to stay as much as you can alive so that you're not dead, so that as a business, so that when things come back to normal, not just you're ready to go back to your business, but you're ready to go back to a new normal, a new reality. So now, the smartest thing to be, you know, is not to be profitable now. Now just stay alive. Now many people have the issue, it's not that if I have money or not, do I have food on the table or not, that's the issue. It's not that if, do we have enough hospital, do we have enough, you know, ventilators, do we have enough masks. So now we're talking about this issue. I mean, look at the US economy. If the US economy now thinks about profitability, it's a foolish thing to think about now. Now it's about how we keep people alive. And they say it all the time, it's very painful, it's killing us what's happening in the economy. Trillions of dollars lost, but nothing compared to human life. Now we stay alive, and then we'll go back to think about, you know, how do we compensate and make money. So now is not the time for profitability. Remember, I talked about readjusting your priorities. What are your priorities now? And that's a reflection of your value system. If you say my priorities now are profit, right? So it shows, and to achieve this profit, I have to fire 50% of my staff to maintain my figures, right? Then you can do that, but that also reflects your value system. So what you're really saying is that I don't care about stakeholders, I only care about shareholders. And that's the new challenge of capitalism now. In my mind, capitalism also will have to change. I'm talking now a philosophical question, right? We have to move from a shareholder mentality into a stakeholder mentality. How do we run the business that's good for everybody, including staff, including suppliers, including society around us, you know, including all parts of the universe that constitutes who we are, not just the shareholders, not just people who put money, because everybody is contributing to this in some way or form. So you have to rearrange your priorities and ask yourself, is profitability now my first priority? If it is, if you're in that business, then go ahead, man. It's a wonderful opportunity. If you're in sanitation, make as many, you know, hand sanitizers as you can. Make as many whatever. Do whatever it takes. Delivery business, do it. Now, if you're smart enough and if you have the right business, then maybe through your business you can find areas where you can do that. I have a friend who's now expanding. Actually, there are two restaurants. One restaurant closed because there are no people who are attending. There's my friend's business, right? He moved his business as a restaurant completely to delivery. So it's the same menu. So he's telling people now through social media, I will provide exactly the same menu right to your homes. And he created the right apps. So his business, guess what? Is expanding to the extent that he's buying now or he's renting the place of his neighbor. He's expanding his business. I know people who are turned the restaurant from conventional way of providing food into like buy your food after Corona. So you can now buy at a discounted rate a meal after this is over. So you buy a card. After like 3 months, you go there. Let's say it was $50 per person. Now you buy a car for $25 or $40, $30, and people are buying it online. After it is over, like, you know, in summer or whatever, you go and show this card and you get the same meal for less. So they're finding other kinds of businesses while not only they're keeping their businesses alive, but they're also making money. They're actually making money. There are some people are making more money than they used to do before. Some people can't even care. I mean, Amazon just hired, whatever, 100,000 more people, right? The dairy business, in some places are making money on some new products, are losing money on other. So now you have to ask yourself these questions and see if there are chances where you can divert, open new lines of business and make new deliveries, then fine. If they're not, then you've really exhausted yourself and maybe you have to be realistic and say, now I need to be smart and stay alive and prepare for what's coming, and then when things are back to normal, there's more than a good opportunity to make money all over again. So the business, the purpose-driven growth model, you know, the PDG model, is still standing. All what you need to do is apply it again, but taking a new reality into effect, because it's all about what's leadership. It's about how do you how do you mobilize people in a current reality, right, so that they can face their challenges and create opportunities so that they can create a new reality where they can survive and grow.
Thank you, sir.
Michael, just a small question. You said by taking advantage of the situation. Now, since people are staying at home, the consumption of food is much higher due to boredom, due to et cetera, et cetera. Now, as a catering provider to an airline, if we rely on the frozen food, taking it and processing it and freezing it and then export it, you as a Lebanese and a culture and the world, would they consume frozen food after we process it and freeze it and all they have to do is put it in the microwave?
It depends on the culture. If the culture is very much reliant on fresh food, then maybe it's harder, especially if food alternatives are available. I mean, if next door you have the grocery open and the butcher is open and they do delivery, maybe you don't need to do that. But I am sure, and maybe this applies to, I was having a conversation with somebody a few days ago and he was telling me how the culture in the US is not a cooking culture. They're usually a delivery or frozen food culture. So in those kind of cultures, we can identify those kind of cultures that are reliant on these kinds of services, on this kind of food, and do not usually are not good, are not much on cooking, then that's definitely a great opportunity, provided you can build trust that this is hygiene, this is good quality, you know, this is trustworthy, and this is better than the current alternative that they have. So is it an opportunity? Yes, it's an opportunity, provided you have discovered where that need exists. But if you talk about my culture, I mean, we have the butcher open and we have a grocer in front of us, and you just call them and they bring food to your home. So we have fresh food every day. but there are millions of people, hundreds of millions, who are not into the cooking culture. So yes, it is an opportunity. And maybe locally also it's an opportunity. If you have this great catering thing, right, you have this entire huge infrastructure of catering, it's sitting doing nothing, so maybe you can start doing that now. It's a great idea. Of course, it has to be studied. But always ask yourself now, with the resources and the strengths and the core strengths and the tools that I have now, okay, how can I use them, adapt them to fulfill either existing needs or new needs in the current reality? Like now I'm doing all these talks. I mean, every day I have webinars and talks. I've moved from being, you know, a speaker on a physical form or on a podium into this. Tomorrow I'm talking to universities in London and the States and in Asia. So every day I spend much of my day doing this. I'm adapting what I have, my core strengths, using the tools of technology. You know, I haven't done this before as much as I'm doing now, to adapt, to offer what I have. So if you can do this, provided you have the need, it has to go to the need, huh? Find the needs and adapt yourself and capture an opportunity. And maybe you don't need to make money now. Maybe what you're doing now is, your objective now is to create a new community of loyal people, clients, who could be your clients in the future. So maybe now you run it at a loss, or you run it at, you know, cost price. But what's happening is that you're developing your a community, a market, with a new habit of relying on you. So that when this is over, they will still be your tribe, your community, and they are in your hands, so you can continue to sell them the same product, but at different rates, or you can start selling them different products.
Hi, my name is Abdullah. First of all, thank you for all the wisdom you've shared. I have a question regarding something that you said. You mentioned that this is not the time to make drastic decisions. And I see the point behind that, and I understand why you're saying that profitability should not be the main objective at this point. In order for us to develop that kind of positive morale in the organization and all that. And I see the point behind that. But I have a question in terms of what we can do to take advantage of this situation in terms of market share. In a competitive market like this, there are many examples from the past, we've seen them, where there are crises that might have not been at the same level as this, that have allowed smaller companies to turn the table against larger companies, against other competitors, to shift the flow of the market, taking advantage of it. So while we might not be able to push for profitability at a time like this, but perhaps, do you not think that this is a good opportunity to take a look at the market and competition and how we can use the current situation to gain more market share?
Yes, I agree 100% with you. You are very right. And by the way, when I said profitability is not number one now, I did not mean if you have an opportunity to be profitable, don't do that. Of course you have to be doing that, of 100%, right? But let's say, I'll give you a silly example. If you are a barber, you know, hairdresser, if you have been forced by the government and the authorities to close, I mean, how can you think of profitability now? How can you be profitable? Maybe you can, I don't know, develop a system where you call people and you go to people's home and maybe provide the services there, I don't know. But what I'm saying is, be as imaginative, as innovative as possible to create areas for profitability. Of course you should do that. That's your job, for God's sake. That's what you should be doing. But what I'm saying, you have to also be realistic about this. I mean, if you're an airport, if you're an airline, and there's a shutdown, and what can you do now? You can't start. I mean, what do? You do taxis? You can't do taxis. So you have to be realistic. But definitely go for profitability if you can find new opportunities. Now, you talked about market share, 100%. I don't know if you've heard, Microsoft Teams, usually it's a service that is paid. Now, what Microsoft have decided a month ago, I think, maybe a little more, that to make Microsoft Teams in its different packages free for everybody now, for 2 or 3 months. Open, free for everybody. Are they wasting money, opportunities of money? Of course, because they usually people, you know, have to pay for this. But because they're making it free to all schools, universities, companies, they're gaining market share. So more and more people now are using Microsoft Teams, right, because it's free, right? And to help them in satisfying their current need at this situation. Now, will all of this translate afterwards, you know, after a few months from now, if Microsoft comes and says, okay, you have to pay me for now, will all of this translate to business? Of course not. But definitely it has scored in terms of branding. Definitely it has scored in terms of customer loyalty. And definitely a serious or considerable percentage of this will say, okay, because you develop habits and we are creatures of habit, right? So now I'm using it and I became acquainted with it and now it's user friendly and I like it and I know it very well. So I'll stay with it. And what is it? So I'll pay $10 a month or $20 a month. What's that? Because it's easier, it's cheaper for me than having to let go of my old habit. So if you can use that, if you can use this opportunity to build branding, to expand your market share, even at the cost of some financial issue, to build a wider or more loyal customer base, definitely do that. People don't forget these things. Definitely do that, because you will cash it in later on. And as I said, God knows what opportunities this will have. This will open for you. So experiment. Do it for 1 week. It didn't work. Do something. I mean, I'll just give you an example. You have all these, you know, catering infrastructure. Why don't you do? Maybe you've done this already. I don't know. I'm just giving it as an example. It might not be applicable. I mean, for 1 week. I mean, do something for free and give it to all poor people. Whatever. Do a campaign. A local campaign nationally, that we're going to provide 10,000 meals, whatever. I mean, I'm just saying that. Maybe you can't have you don't have the money to do it. Yeah, to poor people, right? And brand it and give it to poor people. It will score with people. People will remember that. You see what I'm saying? And then maybe with time, and if you see people have, you know, are liking it and they're happy about it and they got used to waiting for your meal, maybe. You can turn it later on and say, you know what, we're going to spin off this to make it a separate business. And while people are still hooked to you with their habit, you spin it as a separate or side business and you start charging for it. And people don't mind because they have been eating it for free for a week or two or more and they're happy with it. And now they say, okay, we'll pay some money for it, no problem. So that's why I'm saying experiment, experiment, experiment as much as you can if you have the tools to do that. And definitely branding, you can do that. Market share, you can do that. And sooner or later, this will translate. Shuf, listen. Use all the tools that you have. Ask yourself this. How can I use all the tools that I have, all the assets that I have, tangible or non-tangible, to benefit as many people as I can who are living this new reality? What are their needs? Maybe you discover new needs. Just make your machines busy. As much as you can, don't stop them. Make them busy in doing good stuff, right? You will score in so many different ways. Then you can go back to your normal work, or you would have discovered something new. You know that in marketing, 90 to 95, maybe 99% of all products that are made fail. I know Coca-Cola, like in some countries, every month they experiment like, I don't know, 20, 30 new products. Most of them fail, but if one of them succeeds, then they have, you know, a big bang effect. So experiment as much as you can, provided you can do that, right? And then see what happens. Who knows? Instead of keeping things idle. I mean, you have kitchens, use them, do some charity, build some reputation, help your country. I believe that any good you do, sooner or later it will come back to you. People, this is the nature of good. This is the power of good. You do something good, sooner or later, society and the market will come back and pay you multiple folds. So do as much good as you can and see what happens. There's nothing more valuable than gaining one extra loyal client.
Michael, there is one more question from Shilpi.
Hi, good afternoon, Mr. Gole. Good to see you after 2 years, and it is a pleasure to listen to you again. I hope that you are keeping well.
Thank you.
My question to you is that, in your opinion, after this pandemic comes to a close, however that long may be, what should be the first step we as Transom take so that we are better prepared for the next crisis?
First step as who?
As Transom, as Oman Aviation Services, now we call it as Transom, we have rebranded ourselves.
What should be your first, so you're asking what's the first step that you should do when you go back to business?
Yes.
Number one, do a big party and celebrate.
Inshallah.
Celebrate, because especially if everybody is alive, so really celebrate, because this is worth celebration, absolutely worth celebration. And then, I don't know, maybe get focus groups, do some kind of town hall meeting stuff, so that you can capture the learning that has happened of all this time. Do brainstorming sessions to get people immediately locked down before they forget any possible idea that they have about how can they make their business in a better way. So there is a wealth of wisdom sitting there. So don't waste that. So capture all of that, any possible suggestion. Send everybody a message and telling them, if you now need to reinvent your business at the smallest possible department to the biggest department, what would you do now? How would you do things differently? What are suggestions? What should you do more? What should you do less? What should you stop doing? How can we do things more smart? I mean, capture all of that. And then put it all together and see how you can cascade that in a way, or converge it in a way that you can draw big conclusions that will help you in the process of transformation. So involve people as much as you can, involve them so that they are geared enough and they are energetic enough and involved enough to be involved in whatever transformation you want them to do. Because now it's all about how we adapt to the new reality. So number one, we have to define what's the new reality, and you need everybody's contribution to do that at every possible level. At least you'll send them a message of respect when you ask their opinion, right? And you'll be surprised, if you have an open mind, how smart some of the suggestions would be. And then see how you, as management team, you can incorporate all of that into the shape of the transformation that will happen. And once you do that, and once your staff see that their ideas, at least much of them or some of them, are being translated into real action, right? Once this happens, right, then they're already on the amount of resistance that will happen that comes with any transformation is much less, right? So at least they're already on board, because they're seeing their own ideas transforming. So I would suggest go back to every department and ask them the same question that I asked you. How do you transform? If we need to redo your business, redesign it, go back to the board. What would you do differently? What would you stop doing? What would you learn doing? Right? At every possible level. Send this a huge message to everybody, and then incorporate that, and then based on that create a new reality, and then make them do it with all the energy of the world that you need. But first, don't forget to celebrate, and don't forget to remind them and show all gestures that you're extra super happy that they're alive, and that people and their loved ones are alive. Because This should not be about, okay, let's go back to business now and make more money. It's not about that. This is about, thank God we're alive. This has been horrible. So let's party, and then let's see how we can rebuild our business all over again.
Thank you very much. All noted. Very well noted. Thank you.
Michael, thank you so much. Was very inspiring. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome. I wish you all good well, good health. Take care of yourself and your families. And remember, if you come out of this as safe and sound, you and your family and your staff, hopefully, then you're a hero. Everything else will build it up again. I'm very hopeful. After this, it's going to be like a new beginning with all the hope that it offers.
Thank you.